Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning and Fulton McGregor is joining us online. So our first item of business this morning is consideration of a supplementary legislative consent memorandum on the Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. And I'm pleased to welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Angela Constance, and her officials to the meeting. Ms Claire McKinley, Solicitor with the Scottish Government's Legal Directorate, and Mr Michael Halpin, Defence Policy Manager with the Directorate for Safer Communities. And I refer members to paper one and invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks on the supplementary LCM, and then we'll move to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. The UK Government's Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill and subsequent LCM was refused consent when it first came to the Scottish Parliament in October 2022. The UK Government has now proposed amendments to the bill, which we only received in full on the 8th of June. We do not consider that these amendments satisfy our concerns that resulted in the previous LCM being refused consent by Parliament. In its current form, the bill still allows for the granting of immunity to people who apply for it, even though they may have committed serious offences during the Troubles. Effectively, this bill potentially means an amnesty for those who have committed offences such as murder and crimes involving abuse and torture, including where those crimes were conducted by agents of the state. Therefore, the Scottish Government recommends that Parliament maintains its position to withhold consent to the amended Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. Our reasons for doing so focus on three key areas: the ability of victims to seek justice, the Secretary of State's powers to amend devolved legislation, and the impact on the Lord Advocate's responsibilities. Firstly, for those who have been directly affected by the Troubles and are seeking justice, we do not believe the amendments to the bill will increase the opportunities for these families and communities to obtain justice or ensure that those who committed offences during the Troubles are appropriately held to account. We are cognisant that it is not only the Scottish Government which has concerns in this regard. Indeed, this bill was opposed by all parties in Northern Ireland. Also, the UK Parliament's own Joint Committee on Human Rights has previously raised doubts on this bill and its compatibility with the European Convention of Human Rights. Further, the Northern Ireland Office of Amnesty International UK has accused the UK Government of treating victims with contempt and stating that amendments do nothing to address the fundamental flaws with the bill. Secondly, in its current form, the bill provides the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland the ability to amend devolved legislation without having to make the Scottish Government aware of this, let alone seek the Scottish Parliament's agreement to do so. If the UK Government is to respect devolution, then it should not be exercising powers within the devolved competence of the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Ministers, unless doing so is specifically agreed. Lastly, we are concerned the bill, even with its amendments, continues to encroach on the role of the Lord Advocate as the independent head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland. The Lord Advocate's independence predates devolution and is protected by Section 45 of the Scotland Act 1998. However, some of the powers proposed for the independent commission created by this bill undermines that independence and breaches a fundamental cornerstone of our criminal justice system. In previous iterations of the bill, it was the case that even where immunity was not granted, the Lord Advocate could be impeded by the Commission refusing to refer appropriate cases to the Lord Advocate's office. I therefore welcome the amendment proposed by the UK Government, which means that the Lord Advocate can now direct the Commission to refer such a case to the Lord Advocate's office. However, As I have previously mentioned, the Commission is also given powers to grant immunity from prosecution for the most serious of offences. This, in practice, interferes with the independent decision-making of the Lord Advocate in such cases, effectively making the Lord Advocate's decision on whether to be able to prosecute subject to the decision of another person. This means the Bill continues to cut across the Lord Advocate's role. In effect, it is the Commission who will decide whether a prosecution can be raised, not the Lord Advocate. So it is for these reasons, our concerns about the effect this bill will have on those who have suffered and the lack of regard to the role of the Lord Advocate and the protections enshrined in the Scotland Act, that the Scottish Government cannot recommend consent to the bill in its present form. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. I'm now just going to move straight to questions, and I'm going to open it up to members. And I think, Jamie Green, you would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and officials. I had a few questions following on from the opening remarks made by the Cabinet Secretary. I think the first of all is maybe just an overarching one, which is around the Scottish Government's position on what the concept of the bill is trying to achieve. I appreciate there are some subsequent questions around technical issues with regards to the role of the Lord Advocate, and perhaps the Scottish Government has some further questions around the potential implications of the human rights aspects of granting immunity. But from a policy point of view, can I ask fundamentally what problem the Scottish Government has with the concept of either immunity from prosecution in return for information, for example, or the concept of amnesty in general in Northern Ireland? What is its major substantive problem with that?
So, Kavira, I am not going to bring into Northern Irish affairs, and with respect it's a UK government bill, so it's my job to point out where it has implications for our devolved responsibilities in Scotland. What I would say in terms of issues of immunity, it would be my view that issues in and around immunity, as so far as they impact on Scotland, that would be for the Lord Advocate. And in terms of access to justice, that would be a matter for our courts. I am, however, cognisant that all political parties in Northern Ireland have raised concerns about this bill. It is my duty to be clear to this Parliament about what my objections are in terms of the matters in and around the LCM, and that this bill continues to cut across the powers of the Lord Advocate. That is a cornerstone. It's not a matter, it's not a technical matter, it's a fundamental cornerstone of how our criminal justice system works, and also how deaths are investigated in Scotland. And as you would expect, the Scottish Government is going to have very strong views on the ability of the Secretary of State of Northern Ireland, not even to inform, never mind consult, if he steps into devolved matters. So I think these are more than technical matters. I think, from our interests, these are fundamental.
Okay, so respectfully, the question was, as you named it as one of the three pillars of rationale for opposition against granting consent, one of them was the, and it is a philosophical discussion around the concept of whether immunity it should be granted in certain scenarios. Would the Cabinet Secretary not agree that it may be a useful tool to have in the box for the new Commission with regards to maintaining ongoing peace in relation to the fact that it's quite a well-established protocol? I mean, the Good Friday Agreement itself was an effectively one great amnesty on many sides of those troubles. Therefore, it would be a continuation of that. And I'm still struggling to understand what the political opposition is to it.
So the political opposition is, as I have clearly laid out in the statement, and of course maintaining peace in Northern Ireland is of course of paramount importance to anyone, but of course I would refer the member to the views of all political parties in Northern Ireland, which of course in this instance would take precedence over my views.
One issue of the Lord Advocate's functions. Can I ask what correspondence exists between the Scottish Government or the Cabinet Secretary and the Lord Advocate? We haven't, as a committee, seen any letters from the Lord Advocate explaining her position on this matter. So, I mean, obviously, I take your word for it that the government believes that there are issues. But what does the Lord Advocate herself say about the issue? So, and would you be willing to publish any such correspondence?
So I would obviously have to seek advice on that. There has certainly been correspondence between government to government and between the Lord Advocate and the UK government. But in terms of alignment of views, as I said in my opening remarks, that we do welcome the movement that was made by the UK government to reduce the impact on the Lord Advocate's discretion and powers. But nonetheless, because the Commission has the ability to grant immunity, fundamentally, that continues to cut across the Lord Advocate's powers.
Right, OK. So, obviously, irrespective of what the committee discusses, this will probably come back to the Parliament. I believe there's a debate scheduled for next week on this. I wonder if it might be helpful if the Lord Advocate could write to the committee or make a write to the Cabinet Secretary on her current position, given that the previous correspondence that may be available in the public domain was before any such amendments were brought in. So okay. I'd be quite keen to see if it remains the Lord Advocate's position that she has a problem with the legislation, which may make it easier for Parliament to make decisions on it. At the moment, we're certainly hearing third-hand information through the government rather than directly from the Lord Advocate.
Well, I mean, I suppose I would perhaps take issue with what perhaps infers a quite slight on the government and inaccurate reporting. But I mean, nonetheless, what the Lord Advocate communicates to Parliament would, of course, be a matter for the Lord Advocate. But I will certainly ensure that the request for further information is communicated.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. So we've got another couple of members who want to come in. First of all, Russell Finlay and then Rona Mackay. Russell.
Thanks very much. So when was the last Troubles-related police investigation in Scotland?
I wouldn't know the answer to that. I do know that, and officials will keep me right, that there... I don't know the answer to that, and I wouldn't be commenting on any... if there were any live investigations currently, you would understand I wouldn't comment on that.
I imagine they're pretty rare, if there's been any at all in recent years, but is that something perhaps we could come back to?
Yeah, it's not something we have, or I've got information today, we can look into it, but certainly there's currently no live cases right. that are currently going on.
Okay.
What I can say, Convener, is we understand that there are no live cases, right. If that's helpful.
I mean, I guess it might be also useful just to know in recent years if that data is available. One thing that the Commissioner also seeks to be able to do is to release prisoners early as part of the immunity and reconciliation process. How many Troubles-related prisoners are there in Scotland just now?
I don't know. I just have to go and check that information. If there is, if Mr Finlay would want a bit of an overview on how the bill impacts on issues such as prisoners and prison transfer, I could ask Ms McGinley to give you a brief overview if that's what you're looking for.
I think the submission explains how it works and how it might work in Scotland, but I just wanted to know what it means practically in terms of numbers, whether it's more theoretical, which I suspect, or whether there's actually a likelihood of this coming into play here.
Okay, I don't have that data at hand.
No worries.
And we'd have to check if it existed and if it's available.
And just going back to the point Jamie Green raised with the Lord Advocate. Now, the Lord Advocate wrote to the UK Government and some movement was made by the UK Government in terms of amendments. We don't know what the movement specifically was. I think Jamie's rightly asked for this to be provided. But I wonder, is the Lord Advocate satisfied with the UK Government response? Or is this a ministerial decision? As opposed to the Lord Advocate's decision?
It's a government decision. And obviously, in this regard, the Lord Advocate is a minister of the government.
There's full agreement
with
her.
This is not a matter in and around the impact on the Lord Advocate's powers that I would be taking issue with the Lord Advocate about, if I can put it that way. In terms of the change as a result of the amendment, let me answer that question, if I may. The amendments, which is welcome, it just doesn't go far enough. The amendment that has come forward from the UK government is that once the Commission has decided that someone is not being granted immunity, that the Lord Advocate could request that case to be referred to her. But the outstanding issue is that it's the Commission that continues to make decisions about immunity in the first instance and therefore preempts the Lord Advocate. So that's where the change is.
I understand. But given this is fundamentally about the Lord Advocate's independence and to operate in Scotland and take decisions as he or she sees fit, I'm curious to know as to whether she remains dissatisfied with the UK government's position.
Yes, she does.
Right, OK. And finally, the submission refers to the need for people who've committed offences during the Troubles to be punished, and it's not a word we often hear from the SNP government in respect of crime. But what the new commissioner seeks to do is to persuade people to engage truthfully in order that answers can be provided honestly, closure can be given to families and so on. Do you not think one of the consequences or potential consequences of not consenting to this motion is that there will be a fractured approach and could lead to people not getting the closure and the answers they need without a UK-wide approach?
So, I mean, you know, we all appreciate the intent, but of course it's how things operate in practice. And I would point Mr. Finlay to the fact that while the Scottish Government has some very specific concerns in relation to how devolution operates in Scotland and the powers of the Lord Advocate, and also the ability of people who are resident in Scotland who perhaps have been impacted by the Troubles and their abilities to access justice via the Scottish courts when the powers of the Commission close off the opportunities to seek redress either civilly or criminally. These are, of course, real concerns for us here in Scotland. But we're not a lone voice in expressing concerns, and I would point the member to the concerns that have been raised across political parties in Northern Ireland with respect to this bill.
OK, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rona.
Thank you, thank you. Good morning. I just want to say I think it's inconceivable that we would support this bill. The Cabinet Secretary very clearly laid out the reasons at the start, and I'm not going to repeat them all. But, you know, the standouts for me are that it would deny justice to people here and in Northern Ireland who'd been affected by what they call the Troubles. And, you know, the fact that all parties in Northern Ireland did not support this, I think that says it all, really. And I don't even think we should be considering supporting this bill. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Any other members want to come in at all? Okay, very quickly, Jamie, please.
I just wondered what, if so, here's a scenario. If the legislation were to go ahead without Scotland participating in it, being a separate legal system, does the Cabinet Secretary believe that would create either any problems or opportunities? What sort of risk analysis has been done of the bill passing in Westminster without Scotland participating in this? Do you think it would undermine perhaps any policy objectives of the legislation? Would it undermine the work of the Commission? Or would it indeed render much of it useless if, for example, someone who was an accused was residing in Scotland, for example, and would therefore be prosecuted in Scotland but not anywhere else in the United Kingdom. So I just wondered if the government had done any analysis on what that outcome, that scenario, which is a potential scenario, might look like.
So the bottom line is, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, I trust our court system and our system of prosecution. But I mean, while we will continue to seek to engage the UK government in and around further amendments, as you'd expect us to do, the bottom line is that the UK government can proceed with this act at the end of the day. And, of course, Mr Green would be aware of my dissatisfaction with that type of arrangement, but that is the reality that we're in. So I suppose I would dispute the premise of aspects of his question.
No problem. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And Pauline McNeill, I think you'd like to come in too.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You may not be able to answer this, but if the political parties in Northern Ireland and the Scottish Government have got some issues with the way the legislation is framed, albeit there has been some change, what is the driving force behind it then, if not the parties in Northern Ireland? Is it purely the UK Government? It would just seem odd, because usually there's campaigns somewhere behind it that would be pushing the government to do something.
The UK Government?
Yes.
No, I can't comment on that.
Oh, OK. Do you think that's a fair question to ask somebody who could answer
it?
I mean, because where is it coming from? I mean, that's a difficulty I've got in making an assessment on it. And did the Scottish Government fully review what changes had been made?
Yes, I mean, they did come late in the day, so it was only the 8th of June. So we worked as speedily as possible, and will continue to engage with UK as much as possible, but... time is short. As Mr Green said, we will anticipate debating this matter in Chamber next week. In terms of how this legislation will progress at Westminster, it will go to report stage, I believe, next week. That will start next week. And it's also my understanding, not a matter for me, so it is just my understanding that... the UK Government will be seeking progress with this bill before Westminster goes into summer recess. So time's quite short.
Yeah, just trying to get my head around the changes that have been made. I mean, they seem to be, how would you describe them, fairly minor, superficial? Do you think there's any substantive changes since we last discussed it?
I think in terms of the Lord Advocate's powers, I think there are and remain fundamental concerns about how this cuts across the Lord Advocate's constitutional powers.
Yeah, that's still there.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thanks. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So thank you, members, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, our next item of business is consideration of any final issues that we would like to include in our report on the supplementary LCM. So I'm just going to open it up again to members just to come in with any specific issues that they would like included in the report, and then we will move on from there. So Jamie, first of all.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we've had I think the Scottish Government have been quite frank and open about their position on it, whether one agrees or not is a different matter. But I think for the purpose of whether the committee or indeed the Parliament will have to do agree or disagree with the government's position in regards to the LCM, one of the things that has been quite sorely lacking is communication from any other party other than just the conversations we've had in evidence sessions with the Cabinet Secretary. I think if the committee had been given sight of any correspondence and communication between either civil servants, governments, ministers, Lord Advocate, Northern Ireland Office, Secretary of State, and so on and so forth, that may have been helpful. Again, not saying I don't trust the Cabinet Secretary's word on this, but it is very much the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government's opinion on many of these matters, and it would have been helpful, I think, had we had some of that communication in the public domain, where it wasn't breaching any privacy or any individual cases, for example. I understand sensitivities around that. I think that may have helped the committee and will indeed help the Chamber next week as well.
Thanks very much for raising that. I mean, I think, to be fair, I think when we were originally scrutinising the LCM, the original LCM, I think there was quite a lot of communication and good communication at that time. I wouldn't like to see how that's continued in relation to what we're looking at today in terms of amendments, but I think there certainly was pretty robust communication previously. Any other member would like to come in? Russell Fenley.
Thank you. I think it would be quite useful to see set out, and I know we've had sight of, I think, one or two letters, but I can't recall if we've seen the most up-to-date correspondence. I think it would be worthwhile, if it's at all possible, to hear directly from the Lord Advocate. She's a member of the Scottish Government. This relates entirely to her jurisdiction, and I think she can explain more confidently how that would affect potentially her role.
Okay, thanks for raising that. I mean, I think a couple of things there. Time is against us. We're under pressure of time, I'm assuming that if the Lord Advocate had, if there was an update in terms of her position on this matter, then if she felt it was appropriate to share that with the committee or the government, then she would do that. But I think the key issue is timescales, unfortunately. Any other members want to come in? Okay, thanks very much for raising those issues. So we'll make sure that they are included in the committee's report. On that note, the question is, does the committee agree with the Scottish Government that the Scottish Parliament should not give its consent to the relevant provisions in the Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion? So are members content to agree with the Scottish Government that the Scottish Parliament should not give its consent?
Yes.
No. Okay. Can I just check with Fulton?
Yeah, I've got Fulton's vote.
Okay. Okay. So in that case, we will go to a vote. So if I can ask members who are in agreement with the Scottish Government's recommendation to raise their hands. Thank you. And if I can ask members who are not in agreement with the Scottish Government's recommendation, if you can raise your hands. Okay, and I take it from that those... The final question is, members who are abstaining, if you can raise your hands. Okay, thank you very much. That's fine. Thanks very much. So we have, in support of the Scottish Government's recommendation, we have 6 votes, we have no votes against, and we have 2 abstentions. Therefore, the committee agrees with the Scottish Government that the Scottish Parliament should not give its consent to the relevant provisions in the Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion. Okay, thanks very much. So are members content to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on the outcome of the deliberations of the LCM? Okay, thank you very much. So this issue will now move to Chamber for all members to debate based on our report. So with that, I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for attending this morning, and we'll have a short suspension whilst we wait for our next team to come in. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, members. So our next item of business is consideration of a supplementary legislative consent memorandum on the Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill. And I'm pleased to welcome the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, Tom Arthur, and his officials to the meeting this morning. So we have Ms. Shan Ledger, Land Reform Policy and Legislation Team Leader, Mr. George Dixon, Detect and Disrupt Team Leader at the Organised Crime Unit, Michael Papadakis, Civil Law Policy Manager, and Patrick Down, Team Leader, Criminal Law Practice and Licensing Unit. So welcome to you all, and I refer members to paper number 5. And so I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks on the supplementary LCM, and then we'll move to questions, Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the committee, and thank you for the opportunity to make a few brief remarks on the Supplementary Legislative Consent Memorandum for the UK Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill. Since my last appearance before the committee on 24th May, the constructive engagement at official and ministerial level with the UK Government has continued, and I'm pleased to report has resolved matters. The Supplementary Legislative Consent Memorandum lodged on Monday of this week now recommends promoting consent to all relevant provisions in the bill. A series of amendments were made during the course of last week to reflect the outcome of those negotiations. Some new amendments were also made to add in new provisions related to the Register of Overseas Entities and the Identification Doctrine. As such, the bill now has a combination of consent mechanisms, consult plus mechanisms, consult mechanisms, a sunset clause, and ministerial correspondence to offer reassurance on the policy intent of regulation-making powers related to the forfeiture processes for crypto assets. The Scottish Government remains fully supportive of the policy intent of the bill and now recommends promoting consent to all of the relevant provisions in the bill. Thank you.
So I'll just open it up to members for any questions that you'd like to come in on. Okay. Okay, thank you very much. That was nice and short and sweet and simple. Russell?
Just come all the way.
We almost did it.
So just to put that into the most simple terms for my benefit, you sought changes and they've been effectively all agreed to and you're content.
Yeah, we are content. There's obviously areas where we would have liked perhaps to have a consent mechanism rather than a consult mechanism, but we're not going to make the perfect the enemy of the good. I think there's a broad agreement on the policy intent of this, and I'm pleased that through constructive work between officials and ministers we've been able to arrive at this point.
A textbook example of Scotland's two governments working together. Brilliant. Thank you.
Okay, on that note, thanks very much. So I'll move swiftly on. So our next item of business is consideration of any final issues that we want to raise in our report on the supplementary LCM. So again, I'll just open it up to members if there's anything specific that you would like raised.
Just how we make a half-hour debate out of this next week, but I look forward to the Minister's comments.
Okay, nothing from you, Jamie? Good. Okay, if I may, one of the things that I would like to highlight in the report is the comment from the Scottish Government that where the UK Government intends to take powers to make secondary legislation in devolved areas, that must be accompanied by effective mechanisms to represent the devolution settlement and to recognise the responsibilities of Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament. Currently, there is no process for the Scottish Parliament to scrutinise that subordinate legislation, and at this stage, it's not clear what information the Scottish Government will provide to the Parliament to facilitate its scrutiny. So I would propose that we should make these points in our report, and hopefully other members will agree with that. Members content for me to raise that, or us to raise that as a committee?
Can I just clarify what you meant by... Do you mean secondary legislation in the Scottish Parliament or in Westminster?
Sorry, I didn't quite hear that.
Your point was about scrutiny of secondary legislation. Is that secondary legislation that's passed here or secondary legislation that's passed in Westminster with relevance to devolved competencies?
Yeah, so I think where there is ongoing dialogue and between the two governments in relation to how legislation is being developed within bills, then it's not clear to me that the Parliament is aware of what those discussions might be. And it might be helpful for us to have some understanding of that process and perhaps issues that are being raised within that. I don't know if you want to add anything to that or if that pretty much covers it.
Just to assist the member, if that helps. So, yes, as the convener said, when the two governments are in dialogue with each other about secondary legislation that the UK government is going to pass in devolved areas, I think the point the convener was making that it would be helpful for the Scottish Parliament to be informed or better informed of that process. I hope that helps.
Sounds very, very wise. And perhaps, assuming this committee would be the lead committee on any such scrutiny, then that would be entirely appropriate. So.
Okay, thank you. Pauline?
I agree with that, because specifically in relation to the new offence, which I will cover Scotland, in relation to encouraging or assisting serious self-harm, I imagine that, I don't know the background to that particular clause, but I mean, I think there was a big concerning case on social media of self-harm. So would that be an example of something that we would want?
I think you've maybe jumped ahead to our next agenda item. we have a lot in the agenda today.
Confused Marie Todd for the session and then... Okay, sorry.
No worries at all. Okay, we're getting near summer recess, so that's fine. Okay, thanks very much, members. So thank you for your agreement to that. So can I just ask if the committee is in agreement that the Scottish Parliament should give its consent to the relevant provisions in the Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion. Thank you. And Fulton, will take it, please. Yeah, great. Okay, thank you, members. Are members content to delegate to me the publication of a short report that summarises the outcomes of our deliberations on the LCM?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. So the issue now moves to Chamber for all members to decide based on our report. So thank you very much, Minister and officials, for attending the meeting this morning. It's been short and sweet. And we'll have a short suspension while we wait for the next minister to arrive. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, members. So our next item of business is consideration of a supplementary legislative consent memorandum on the Online Safety Bill. And I'm very pleased to welcome Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, and her officials to the meeting. So we have Ms Hilary Third, Head of Self-Harm Policy and Distress Interventions, Mental Health, and Katie Richards, Solicitor. And I refer members to paper number two. I have just got, there we go, yep, there we are, some place there. So I now invite the Minister to make some opening remarks on the supplementary LCM, and then we'll move to questions. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to meet with the committee today. I'll take a few minutes to outline what I will refer to as the self-harm amendment, which has triggered the requirement for a legislative consent motion, and explain why the Scottish Government is recommending consent. This committee has previously considered an LCM for the Online Safety Bill. The self-harm amendment creates an offence of communicating material that could encourage another person to engage in serious self-harm. The proposed penalties on summary conviction are an imprisonment for a term not exceeding 12 months or a fine or both. An indictment conviction, the proposed penalties are imprisonment for a term not exceeding 5 years or a fine or both. Now, as members are aware, self-harm is a complex and sensitive issue, and it is for many people a response to emotional distress. It's very often hidden, and while the data is quite poor, there is evidence that is increasing, particularly that it is increasing, particularly amongst young people. And whilst we know that self-harm can be a way of managing distress, it also has the potential to cause serious physical and psychological damage. And furthermore, we know that self-harm can be a predictor for future suicide risk. The Scottish Government is already taking strong action to improve support and care for people who have self-harmed. For example, we're investing in specialist support and working in partnership with people with lived experience to develop a new self-harm strategy and action plan. This will be published later this year. We recognise there's some really helpful information and support available online. However, there are also significant risks that people could encounter when they are looking for help online. This can expose people who are already vulnerable to harmful and malicious content and result in more serious injury and perhaps even suicide. Since late 2022, the Scottish Government has engaged extensively with a range of organisations and directly with people with their own experience of self-harm on the potential implications of this proposed offence. There is consensus that this offence will bolster online protections and help prevent the risk of serious self-harm and potential suicide deaths. Some stakeholders have questioned whether the offence could criminalise vulnerable people who communicate about their experiences of self-harm with peers online as a way of providing or receiving support. The UK Government's position, with which I agree, is that this offence should only capture the most serious encouragement of self-harm. To that end, the amendment seeks to define the scope of the offence narrowly, with a high threshold to only prosecute acts which could result in serious harm and where there is a deliberate intention to encourage or to assist that harm. With this in mind, it is the Scottish Government's view that the new offence will ensure strong action can be taken to prosecute people who share material intended to encourage others to self-harm. It will act as a deterrent to people communicating harmful or malicious messages in the first place. Extending the offence to Scotland will therefore strengthen protections for people online, and it will ensure that the internet is a safer place for anybody, and in particular for people seeking mental health or self-harm support. So in closing, I'd like to make three points in support of the proposed amendment. Firstly, the Scottish Government recognises the need to balance creating a safe environment for people at risk of self-harm alongside facilitating non-stigmatising, compassionate and effective support, which may include online support. We consider this amendment sits comfortably with these dual aims and aligns very well with our ambitious approach on self-harm. Secondly, on balance, we consider that there is significant value in clarifying the legal framework for prosecuting and deterring communications encouraging acts of self-harm in a consistent way across the UK by extending this offence to Scotland. And thirdly, we consider that extending the offence to Scotland will act as a deterrent, as well as providing a robust means of prosecuting deliberate acts of communicating material intended to encourage self-harm. I hope that the committee supports our view that the legislative consent motion is necessary, and I'd be happy to deal with any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. It's a very helpful overview. So we'll now move to questions. I wonder if I can just come in firstly, ask a little bit about if we understand what the scale of the problem is at the moment, either in the UK, but obviously with reference to Scotland at all. I would imagine it's quite a difficult thing to measure, other than we know that it is escalating. So I just wondered if there was any sort of indicators of what the scale of the problem is. And also, secondly, just a wee bit about the challenges that we might face actually applying the new legislation. I appreciate those are quite big questions, but I'd be just interested to know, given the online sphere that we're looking at.
Hilary may want to say a little bit more about self-harm, but self-harm itself is quite hidden, and it's very hard to get reliable data on the prevalence throughout the population, even in Scotland, where it is an area that we are very keen on making an improvement in. So the condition itself is quite hard to know how common it is and how many of those people who self-harm are accessing information on the internet that might encourage them to harm more or to harm more dangerously is really quite unknown. We do hear anecdotal evidence, though, and there is undoubtedly a recognition that there is whether it's a true rise or whether it's that the stigma has been removed and people are talking about it more, but we think there is an increase amongst young people, and young people live online. They're innately able to navigate that space. It is their space as much more than it is for older people. So I think it's important that we're ready and prepared for that shift in behaviour. In terms of how it will be prosecuted, they've been very careful about ensuring that the threshold is narrow so that it doesn't capture people who aren't behaving in a criminal way. And I think that much of the aim is to discourage this type of behaviour, to make it possible to police it without ever actually having to prosecute it, as is the case with much criminal legislation. What you want is to shift the culture so that it doesn't happen in the first place, rather than having to prosecute the offences once they've occurred.
Yeah, thank you.
I think the Minister's covered most of the main points and really, really thoroughly. The data sources are not robust because it would require somebody to attend, for example, a hospital appointment or a GP and disclose that self-harm, and very often it's behaviour that's hidden and people don't seek medical attention. Added to that is the fact that it's a very stigmatised behaviour, which means that people may be unlikely to seek help. But the work we've done looking at more community sources does suggest that it's far more widespread than quantitative data would suggest, and that it could be growing, particularly amongst some groups.
Absolutely. And I think, as you said, Minister, one of the important areas of work is in and around sort of that preventative work that's going on, and I suppose prevention and intervention, which is absolutely key.
Very focused in the mental health portfolio on early intervention and prevention. That's very much where our focus lies. And as I said, we've got a mental wellbeing strategy being launched in the next couple of weeks, but we will also have a specific self-harm strategy launched later in the year, which is, that's... I'm keen to say world-leading, certainly innovative. It is not common for for countries to recognise the challenge that self-harm presents and to produce strategies to tackle it. So it is not a well-recognised issue. It is hidden, it is stigmatised, and we are really trying to shift the balance of that in Scotland.
Thanks very much. I know quite a number of members are wanting to come in. So I've got Jamie, then Colette. Jamie, first of all.
Thank you. Getting quite a lot of feedback this morning. Can I ask, these are maybe technical questions, but rather than sort of wider policy questions. The bill as presented, thanks to amendments that were passed 165 and 166 at the committee stage in the House of Lords, state that the new offence can be committed where the act is committed outside of the UK by a person who is habitually resident in the UK or by a person who is a body incorporated or constituted under UK law. I'm quite keen to explore what effect that has on Scottish law and prosecution, because obviously someone can be habitually resident in different parts of the UK and therefore would they be prosecuted under this legislation in England, Wales or in Scotland? So in a scenario, for example, you have, I won't name any particular social media company, but you can use your imagination, where the somebody is accountable under the parameters of being a corporate officer, for example, and therefore is liable under that parameter, and habitually resides in Edinburgh, for example, but the company, say, is registered in London. Would they be prosecuted because the company is registered in London? Would they be prosecuted in Scotland? Or if both of those scenarios were both the company and the person were resident in Scotland, would it be a lot clearer? But the act could be committed outside of the UK, for example, in the US. So it's just a bit unclear as to how that would roll out in practice.
So I think that, and I'll let Katie come in, I think that would probably depend on the circumstances of the individual case, but I think your question illustrates why it is an important thing that we have similar legislation right across the UK. So that's one of the reasons why we are recommending consent, is because we recognise that the borders for this type of offence are not as clear-cut as they might be for one that happens in real life rather than in virtual life. So I think it's really important that it does work across the UK. I don't know, Katie, if you want to say a little bit more.
Thank you, Minister. I'm not sure that there is a huge amount more that I can say at this stage, because I think it will depend upon the facts of each individual case. But the drafting has been put in here to ensure, as Minister said, because it's an online environment, that there can still be prosecutions within a relevant jurisdiction, even if that takes place outside of the jurisdiction. We'd be happy to write to the committee to give a fuller answer if that would be helpful.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the online and tech industry is growing in Scotland, and there will be a number of people in quite senior management positions who ordinarily reside, or as it's quoted, habitually resident in Scotland, and whether or not they would be prosecuted under Scots law or under England and Wales, if the primary factor was where the person is resident as opposed to where the company is registered or where the offence took place. So it was just a bit of clarification around that, and I know they are hypothetical scenarios and hopefully few and far between, but it wasn't entirely clear from the notes what the scenario would look like. And I guess following on from that is, what analysis has been done by the Scottish government as to perhaps the scale of companies that this may, may fall into this category? How many, do we know how many large social media companies or tech companies where this is, you know, very relevant, have corporate headquarters in Scotland, or are most of them based elsewhere?
So, I mean, I would say that we don't have great data on that. As I said to the convener in our first question, we don't have robust data that tells us how much self-harm activity is happening in Scotland. We also don't have enough data that tells us how much is being encouraged by online behaviour. So I think we can be confident it would be rare that a prosecution would occur. The threshold is narrow and well-defined. There has to be intent, and it has to, initially a warning would be given. It would be, you know, it'd have to be deliberately pushing. So I don't think it will be a large, wide-scale, a large-scale level of prosecution from this particular amendment. I guess this amendment and much of the bill is trying to shift the culture to ensure that people, individuals and corporate organisations can be held responsible for the actions that they take, and much of it is about shifting the culture and preventing harm rather than enabling prosecution.
Thank you. And I guess that's obviously a fairly high level where, you know, I imagine those prosecutions would be quite well publicised and of huge media interest, particularly where they relate to well-known online platforms. But obviously the bill does cover and creates a new offence, a very specific one of encouraging or assisting serious self-harm of another person. That could be interpreted, although the offence itself is narrow, that could be interpreted quite widely. So encouraging someone to self-harm strays from, I guess, one territory where we commonly associate online encouragement of self-harm to almost to the point of online hate crime, where the encouragement of self-harm is used perhaps more as an attack or an insult rather than something that's perceived to be of assistance, which means it could be quite widespread. And we're all on social media and we all read these kind of comments. So I wonder what implications that would have for the policing of that. We have in the past heard of concerns that sometimes legislation is passed, but there's not enough. There isn't a wide range of conversation with, for example, Police Scotland, who ultimately pick up the calls when people phone in and complain or make complaints of this or allegations of this nature. I just wondered at what the minister, conversations I've had with other cabinet secretary colleagues, for example, in other directorates around the resource implications or perhaps the scale and volume or the public awareness that might go along with this, so that we don't suddenly overnight create the perception of a new offence which the public will respond to.
So I don't think we really run the risk of this because it's so narrowly defined. The amendment defines the scope of the offence very narrowly and with a high threshold. So there has to be an intention to encourage, and it has to be so encourage or assist, and it has to be serious self-harm. So it really is quite narrowly defined. I don't think it is an amendment that can be used. I would not expect it to be used widely. As I've said, we would expect what we're aiming for and what the UK government is aiming for with this particular bill as a whole is shifting the culture. I don't think it could be used maliciously because of those high thresholds. I think it would be relatively safe, actually. That is why we're recommending that we consent to this LCM, because we think it is a helpful additional amendment rather than we don't foresee any risk of it being wrongly used or too widely used.
Thank you, it's very helpful.
Very much. I've got Colette and then Katie. Come on, Colette. Thanks, convener. I'm getting a bit of feedback as well. And Jamie kind of took on my line of question in terms of the corporate body liability. But one thing I will ask is, and it's probably a technical question as well, is more to do with it's saying that Ofcom's going to be the regulator for this, particularly with social media sites. Is this something that they will, and you mentioned about initially they'll be given a warning before being prosecuted and held liable for it. Will they be providing regular reports, like quarterly reports, and stating whether warnings have been given out and prosecutions as well? Is that something that you'll get on a regular basis?
So it's a regulatory bill, and Ofcom will act as regulator with powers to take action against the companies that don't follow their new duties, including fines, and the criminal action will be taken against senior managers who fail to follow information requests from Ofcom. Ofcom, I presume, will regularly present information as they currently do. They'll just this type of information will be added to their regular reports. It's to the UK government, though, rather than to the Scottish Parliament, although, of course, we should be able to access that information.
Okay. No further questions, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much.
Katie and then Rona.
My understanding of this legislation is that it is very much a positive piece of legislation, but there's been much criticism of it in that it could be stronger. I wondered whether either today or maybe perhaps in writing to the committee after today, if the Scottish Government could maybe outline what further changes they think needs to be made at Westminster level in terms of legislation to provide a stronger statutory framework.
Yeah, we certainly could, although the UK Parliament have had extensive engagement with stakeholders, including the Scottish stakeholders, who are content with this particular amendment. There may be concerns about the wider bill, or people may well want the wider online harm bill to go further than it does. But with this particular amendment, our stakeholders in Scotland are particularly content with it. There was a concern, as you might imagine, from people with lived experience that it might criminalise, as I said in my opening statement, people who are simply sharing their own story in order to seek support or to provide support. And we have found that the UK government have listened very carefully to those concerns, and we think that this amendment has been crafted well to land in the right place with the appropriate balance and proportionality there. I don't know if there's more you want to say.
Just that ministers have written to the UK government on a number of occasions, making observations about the broader bill. Most recently, the First Minister wrote earlier this month, but that's probably outside of the scope of today's conversations, but presumably we could share that if that's of interest.
Thanks. And I think I'd just sort of add in, as you know, the committee has been looking at the sort of broader issue of online child sexual exploitation and the sort of escalating incidence of that, and obviously our discussions have incorporated the bill and its and progress. So we hopefully are in a position to remain sort of cited on sort of government's position in and around the bill in particular. But it's an issue that the committee is very interested in. Okay, thank you. We've got Rona and then Russell.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. I just wanted to say that I think this is an incredibly important amendment, and I'm delighted that the Minister and the Scottish Government are taking this so seriously and are emphasising prevention and culture change as well. I think that's a really, really positive way. And my question really is, do you know if the UK Government are planning to evaluate this in any way? And I'm sorry if I've missed this in the notes, but if an evaluation of how it's working will be done?
Sure, that would be part of the normal post-legislative scrutiny process, I imagine, for the UK government.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. It's me. Thank you.
Thank you. And Russell?
Thanks very much. As with the Economic Crime Bill, it's good to see both governments working so effectively, constructively together. Now, in your when you spoke, you talked about the world-leading self-harm strategy. You were reluctant to call it that, but I see the document does call it that. Yeah, you're being modest. I know you can't, and I wouldn't expect you to, go into detail just now. But can you at least indicate whether it might include a legislative element, or is it more non-legislative?
It's more about shifting the practice and culture, and recognising that the condition exists. As I said, there's one of the real challenges with self-harm is that it is hidden because it is such a stigmatising behaviour. So it's really about shifting the culture and practices and ensuring that our health and social services, so all of our public services, can recognise and give compassionate support to people who are in that situation.
Right, great. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, thank you, members. If there's no other questions, then we'll just, as usual, we'll move on to our next item of business, which is consideration of any specific issues that we'd like to include in our final report on the supplementary LCM. I think for me, I think it would be very much a case of the committee very much welcomes the Scottish Government's position. It's an important step forward. It provides clarity. It's perhaps not without its challenges in and around the enforcement of the specific piece of legislation, and obviously there seems to be some agreement around the important role that data and evaluation it has. So can I just again open it up to any other members who would like to include any specific issues in our report? If there's nothing specific, we will move on. So can I ask the committee if members agree that the Scottish Parliament should give its consent to the relevant provisions in the Online Safety Bill as set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And are members content to delegate to me the publication of a very short factual report on the outcome of our deliberations of the LCM?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. So the issue now moves to the Chamber for all members to decide based on our report. So with that, can I thank the Minister and her officials for joining us this morning, and we'll have a short pause to allow the Minister to leave. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you, members. So our next item of business is consideration of some follow-up correspondence received from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety after we considered the issue of police searches for pyrotechnic devices outside football matches and other events. And I refer members to paper 3. So can again I just open up to members and ask if you have got any issues or comments that you want to make on the letter that we received. Russell, you want to come in?
Yeah, thanks very much. Now, the Minister, when she gave evidence, it was a few days after a particular football match at Hampden in which scores of people had pyrotechnics within the ground and the kick-off was delayed and so on. My line of questioning was why could the existing legislation not have dealt with that? And I think the letter confirms what we knew, which is it could and it should have been able to do so. So I just put on the record that the new legislation doesn't appear to be needed to deal with this particular problem of pyrotechnics and football grounds, unless I'm completely misunderstanding something. And it's just as he was putting out there.
Okay. I'll come back to that. Jamie, I think you want to come in as well.
Thank you. Yeah, a couple of points. First, just following on from Russell Finlay, was a valid question, I think, of the government, and that's, does the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Article Scotland Act 2022 give any new powers? And I think the understanding was that it was mostly in relation to the ability to stop and search, not necessarily around the possession, which in certain environments, which, as Russell Finlay already said, is already illegal. So it was a bit unclear as to what will happen in future with regards to this Act versus existing legislation, and what training or communication was happening with Police Scotland. so the officers on the ground at these big events, and it's not just football events, other sporting and musical events. In fact, I was watching some footage of a music festival which will remain unnamed, and there were lots of people in the audience flying flares of smoke coming out of them, and it just made a complete mockery of the fact that this committee spent a year on that bill to stop that happening. Needless to say, they weren't rioting, they were all having a good time, but that's by the by. I'm on the letter itself, though, and I'm grateful to the Minister for Community Safety to respond. I think she was in some part responding to some very specific questions I posed in that session. And there are two things that I wanted to query. The first is in relation to someone who is stopped under suspicion of committing an offence under the new Act. The letter states that if a prohibited item is found, it will be seized and retained. That makes complete sense. The individual will most likely be taken into police custody. That's intriguing. That's not evidence that we took from Police Scotland, but if that is the case, I would find that interesting. But it's also the case that many people are released without charge under investigative liberation, as the phrase goes. It then goes on to say that an individual may be given certain rules to follow, such as telling the person not to go to a certain place or speak to certain people for a certain period of time. And I'm quite intrigued by that. I just wonder under which power the police, after liberating somebody who's not been charged and clearly says without charge, whether they can be given specific instructions not to attend certain places and certain groups of people. So in the scenario where someone's been stopped outside a football game, an item's been removed, they've then been released, perhaps even on the spot after investigation without charge, but pending further investigation, whether the police have a power to remove that person or to say that to that person they must then remove themselves from the vicinity of the stadium. And it's just a bit unclear as to how that would work in practice. Because the letter seems to fall back on the admissibility of that individual being the responsibility of the event organiser or the location of the event themselves. The second is about the lifetime banning orders, which is a question that I raised. And it seems to be that there's still a bit of a loophole here. So my question originally was whether this could be an effective additional tool where somebody under this Act is stopped and found to be in possession of illegal articles in that scenario. It seems to me that they can only be given a football banning order, which can be quite lengthy, if that person is also in breach of the Police Public Order and Criminal Justice Act, which specifically says they must be engaged in violence or disorder. Now, being caught with fireworks and flares at a football match doesn't necessarily mean disorder and violence if they haven't used them, for example. And it seems to me that it is that piece of legislation which would have to be altered to reduce the threshold for the introduction of FBOs. So my question to the Minister would be, is that something the government will consider doing? Because ultimately the threshold is extremely high for the introduction of banning orders at the moment. So someone could be a repeat offender and turning up with flares. They may even be barred from the venue or the stadium, but they wouldn't be given a lifetime ban order in the current scenario. And I just think there's certainly room for improvement on that. And I wonder if the government would respond to that.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else want to come in? No. Okay, thanks for that. I think a lot of the points that both Russell Finlay and Jamie Green have made are reasonable. I mean, the letter does set out the current sort of position around legislation, which, if you like, does, in the context of this discussion around pyrotechnics, has perhaps one or two gaps. But I was pleased to see or to read that the minister is having further discussions along with officials, with Police Scotland, clubs and authorities, and other stakeholders around the effectiveness of the FBOs, which is welcome. I think the point that you made laterally, Jamie, was key, was around a course of conduct. So my understanding, but again, we can perhaps ask the questions, in relation to orders is that a course of conduct is anticipated before an order would be placed on someone. So I think that's a practical issue at the moment. But and in relation to the lifelong ban, I think again that would apply. They would be looking for a series of conduct that indicates that a person is not desisting from their behaviour, i.e. continuing to take pyrotechnics, for example, into a ground. But I think we've noted these points that you've raised, and if the committee's happy, we can go back to the Minister and ask with some further questions. Yep. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So our final item of business is consideration of a second piece of correspondence on the issue of policing and mental health, and I refer members to paper 4. So I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for her helpful update, and I certainly welcome the creation of the cross-ministerial working group on this important matter. I think the committee's interest in this issue and the priority that we've given it is hopefully beginning to have some impact, and we're beginning to see some progress being made to address the matters that we have highlighted. So, again, I'll just open it up to members and ask if you'd like to raise any points or further questions on the Cabinet Secretary's letter. Russell.
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, the letter's very detailed and a lot of it is very welcome, but I think what I've noticed is what's not in there. You know, we've repeatedly raised the issue of officer suicides, mm-hmm. and with the usual caveat, of course, suicide being complex, but specifically how the complaints and discipline process appears to have been a factor in a number of deaths, and speaking to people who either serving or former officers who believe that that is in desperate need of scrutiny by the government, by the SPA, by Police Scotland and indeed the Crown Office. And the letter does not really address these concerns that have been raised by these families and by these officers who've either attempted to take their own lives, or families who are grieving the loss of a loved one who is completed suicide. So I just think it's perfectly proper that the government and others are talking about both the policing of people in the community with mental health problems and recognising the impact that's having on officer mental health. But I still think there's a reluctance to properly look at the difficult issue of where there have been deaths and where there has been a contributory factor of what the officers have experienced due to their workplace issues.
Thanks for that, Russell. I just remind members that we are running a session, an evidence session in public next week, looking at the issue of police officer suicide. So hopefully that might be an opportunity to raise some of the issues that you've just outlined, Russell, because I know you're very interested in this particular issue. Any other members want to come in at all? Jamie?
Yeah, thank you. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the update? Two points from the second page of the letter, the two middle main paragraphs. The first one is about the Scottish Government Distress Brief Intervention Programme, which I think was new to me, certainly, and sounds very, very positive and helpful. But I just wanted to clarify if it was... if it sounds to me that that can only be instigated if someone presents to a 999 emergency call or perhaps other calls to emergency services, and it is dealt with at a call handling stage. Therefore, when the caller presents with either themselves or on behalf of someone, a decision is made in the call centre whether that call is then directed to Police Scotland to send someone out to, or whether it's sent to this distress brief intervention, but it's unclear as to where that is. Or is it the case that the call, in terms of the flow of it, goes to Police Scotland, but it's flagged as a potential DBI, therefore an officer doesn't attend? Because it seems to imply that it's one or the other. So I'm a bit unclear, and I would really find it helpful to understand the logistics of how that call handling goes and where that call ends up in relation to how someone is attended to. I've never heard of this intervention. I don't know anyone that has. It's live in 20 HSCPs. It'd be helpful to know which ones it is live in. Obviously, they're making progress to roll that out. But in practice, how is it actually working, and how do people access the service? Sounds like a very good service. 2 weeks of very direct intervention, and one-to-one perhaps with somebody who needs that help. But I know a number of constituents who would benefit from that immediately, but I've no idea how you access it. The second one is a comment made, which I just want to question, where it says each health board is providing access to a mental health clinician accessible to police officers 24/7 for those who require urgent mental health assessment or urgent referral to local mental health services. My conversations with officers and their representatives is that isn't the case. It's absolutely not a 24/7 service. I'm intrigued to know what this access to a mental health clinician actually looks and feels like on the ground. Is it just a phone number? Is it someone who will attend in situ? Is it somewhere that people can, that the police will take someone to? Is it a physical environment? It's certainly not a 24/7 environment. If that were the case, then the police wouldn't be responding and spending so much time dealing with people with mental health difficulties. So I'm not entirely convinced that statement bears true in the real world, and I think we should do a bit of work on investigating that comment further.
Okay, thank you. I know that DBI has been an option for quite a number of years, in fact. It's relatively straightforward, and my understanding is that police officers, for example, can use DBI as a referral option for somebody that they encounter who's experiencing poor mental health. Now, that would normally ultimately be rooted into their GP, who would then pick up that referral and engage with the person. There may be some other points of contact along the lines or along that pathway, but I do know that it's considered to be a successful, a sort of user-friendly and certainly a well-established option. But if it would be helpful, and if members are happy, very happy to ask for some more detail on DBI, because I think it is quite an important tool in the overall toolbox. I just want to clarify, Jamie, in relation to your second point, was it in relation to the enhanced mental health pathway that you were...
No. So it's again page 3 of the letter, yeah. In the third substantive paragraph where it states that each health board implies provides access to a mental health clinician accessible to police officers 24/7, which, I mean, isn't, you know, again, a surprise to me. The feedback is that very much out of hours that's not the case, and that police officers have to deal with mental health assessments, and that there is not 24/7 access to mental health clinicians for every officer. So I don't, you know, the claim that every health board is currently providing 24/7 mental health clinician service, I would find difficult to believe. But if it's true, it's welcome, but maybe we could benefit from some more detail on that.
Again, I'm more than happy to pick that up and ask for some more information and detail in and around that. Members are happy with that? Yep. Okay, any other points that anyone wants to raise? If not, thank you, members, and that concludes our business for this morning. And I'll close this meeting, and we're now going to move into an informal private session, and we'll have a short break. Thank you.